put off by how long this video is. Don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. Die Brücke, or The Bridge, from 1959. Starting, as usual, with the plot. This is set in a small town in Germany, and near the end of the Second World War. And there are these seven boys in school, each about 16 years old, and they're oblivious to the seriousness and dangers of the war, feeling excitement about how close the fighting is getting to them. And they live their lives as normally as they can. And well, though they do have personal problems, and the front moves closer every day, and then they're conscripted. Now, the movie is an hour and 38 and a half minutes with the credits, and without them, it's just 1 minute shorter, and the end credits play over complete silence. The sound of the film cuts off just as the credits start, and it's been too long since I've really watched other movies from this period, but I'm fairly certain that that was a choice and not like, well, we can't both do sound and roll credits. And it really, yeah, it's very, it's grim. It has a very strong effect. Now, moving on to on plot. Now, it's the book is a West German the film is also West German, and I'm probably gonna butcher this name, but it was written by Gregor Dorfmeister under the pseudonym of Manfred Gregor, and published in 1958, and it is an autobiographical account of forced youth service late in World War II, and basically, as far as I understand, the author was a journalist, and he spoke to a surviving, you know, and these years later, in the late 50s, he spoke to someone who was there in 1945 and was 16 years old and was conscripted along with his classmates. And the film was made as soon as it could be, basically in 1959. And this has a lot in common with All Quiet on the Western Front, which is also amazing. And this is incredibly authentic, and you know, part of it is when it's made such a short period of time after the war actually ended, it's fresh in people's memories, and things look roughly the same and such. And, you know, Germany, I feel like it was only a little later that they got really, you know, especially into this, but that's completely forgivable. But they have a bit of a history of confronting the ugly past head on, you know, and I will be reviewing Der Untergang or Downfall as well. And, you know, they also, I want to say a few years after Downfall, they made, I forget what it's called, but about Bader Meinhof complex, I want to say it's called, about, yeah, which is also a very, very bad part of their history, and more recent, of course. And it also helps that this was made by Germans, and the, you know, in Germany, in German. And the, you will lose something if you don't know a lot about, you know, about Germany and about small towns in Germany during the, you know, the ending of World War II. But, you know, I will say it's something where if you watch it and there's like a bunch of stuff that you just don't quite, you know, something about it, you're not quite sure what it means. You know, this is the kind of thing where if you then go and research and then watch it again, it'll be worth that. And yeah, the very first shot of the film is the water under this bridge, and this is a serious video, so I'm not going to make a silly joke about that, being hit by a bomb, and it is this kind of tranquil, you know, it's just, you know, this river under a bridge, and it's quaint, and suddenly the real world, the ever encroaching front literally hits. And yeah, I don't know if an English dub exists of this, but I kind of hope not, though you do of course lose a lot. I watch in Danish, you know, Danish subtitles. The DVD doesn't have English, unfortunately, and of course you do lose a lot with that kind of, and it's unfortunately it's that kind of slightly slow subtitles where they're a little more like, well, we should give people time to read this whole subtitle. And yeah, you lose a lot of detail. There's one short sequence where the boys are like mocking one of, you know, the six of them gang up on the seventh, and in German they yell like they you know, they're going on and on, all these things they're yelling at him for several seconds, and it gets translated into just two or three lines in the subtitles. So yeah. And, you know, in the movie, you know, coming out in West Germany, the Bundeswehr had only recently been created in 1955, with conscription in Germany beginning in 1956. So, yeah. And, you know, they're teenagers, so you see them do typical teen boy stuff, you know. One of them has this little mouse, and he's like saying he's gonna release it, you know, during class. And yeah, they you know, they go playing together and such. And this really gets into gender roles and relationships between boys and girls and men and women, you know, romantic or otherwise. And yeah, there's really a lot to, you know, there are a lot of things where it's just like, just a little look or a single line or something. There's... Yeah. One of them is talking about giving something to one of the girls. You know, he talks to a girl, it's just the two of them, and he says, I want you to have this. And she's reluctant to take it, because if a girl accepts a gift from a boy, you know, that, and yeah, if you don't really think about it, it just goes right by. It's not made a big deal out of. And he clearly doesn't understand why it's, you know, he's just like, I like you, I want to give you this. And it gets into rationing and desertion. And there are a couple of times where the boys encounter veterans, and they're all cynical. The mother of one of the boys asks one of the veterans, you know, my 16-year-old was just conscripted. Could he be at the front? And the response is just, since yesterday? That's not enough time to get a medal. Why go there already? And one of the veterans throws, like, this little pack of chocolate to one of the kids and says, here, kid, have some chocolate before they eviscerate you. I'm translating. I don't know what the German word exactly means, but yeah. And at one point, you know, they're addressed by an officer, and he says, nice circus. They'll give you something that glints for your chest. Now go home to your mothers and be celebrated as heroes. And you see several times kind of temporary relief, the, you know, just at not being dead, or maybe not even being injured. And the production values are incredible, and the realism is really strong. Now, some say that some of the early scenes aren't very tense, but I feel like it just shows the contrast well. It's before they're in the military or at the front, and yeah, it really shows that to the boys it's not tense. They don't understand. They just think it's fun. Right before class, they're looking at the map, and they're like, the front just moved even further. And one of them actually jokes, it would be nice if a bomb would hit, you know, maybe a bomb will hit here. And one of the others says, could it happen before math starts? And, you know, then yet another jokes, you should send the what's that called in English again? Yeah, you know, when you go to school, you have like a sheet of when you're going to which class. You know, you should send that sheet to Churchill. And it's incredibly suspenseful and intense. And the effects are really, really strong. And there's really bloody violence and disturbing content. Now, the tanks are actually, none of them are real, because the German army did not have tanks in 1959. So the director had wooden models constructed, and they were placed on top of truck chassis. And yeah, you can see the wheels under the tank body. And yeah, once you see that, you can't really unsee it. But they do have realistic tank tread movement. And I implore you to also read the book itself. It's 159 pages, so there's a bunch of stuff that they could not fit into the movie. And there's more really strong characterization in it, though they do a really great job of shortening a lot of it here. And there are not a lot of characters in the book who don't at all appear in this. Some of them just don't appear for very long, and, you know, maybe especially compared to the book. And there's a lot of flashbacks in the book where, you know, that's always when you translate a novel into a feature film, yeah, often flashbacks get cut entirely or turned into earlier scenes or such, and some of that happens here, and that's also why you have these earlier scenes that are not so intense. You know, the book also doesn't start with them at the front and such, but there are flashbacks throughout the entire book, even long into the battle and such. And yeah, it's just a really, really great book. Now, moving on to the characters. The boys, I'm not going to go through every single one, but there's Carl, who has this crush on his hairstylist father's young assistant, and he catches them, you know, I'm going to use the wiki's direct words, see them in an intimate situation, and he's shocked, and he's really adorably awkward around her, and, like, you know, in the book you have a lot of time spent, you know, explaining how he's really in love with her. In the movie, you know, you use shorthand, so he literally drops his books because, you know, being awkward around her, and she finds, like, this pad where he's drawn her and written her name a bunch of times, and I think there are, like, hearts as well, and yeah. And she's surprisingly, she really doesn't seem to quite understand that that's what's going on, but then, yeah, you know, sometimes adults don't really understand what teenagers are thinking about and such. And that's also where some of the gender stuff comes in. Once he's seen them, you know, it's him or the father who get her, and he maybe didn't even really think about exactly what being with her would mean, but yeah. And then he starts saying that all girls are really awful. You know, I really hate to use that word, but it is what is referred to as the Madonna whore complex. And there's Klaus, who is oblivious to the affections of his classmate Franziska. And there's this, that's the, with, you know, he gives her a watch, and she's like, you know, and at the same time, she doesn't want to outright refuse, in part because, you know, back then, girls didn't refuse when boys said things, and also she does like him, so she does kind of want, but then, you know, and he's talking about how it's really, you know, the numbers basically light up in the dark, so it's really practical to have. And later on, not long before he leaves, once he knows that he will be leaving, he asks her, can I ask you a question? And she's, yeah, okay, are you sure it's all right? Yeah, sure. Can I have my watch back? And you can just, she's just devastated. That was not at all what she hoped that he would be asking. And there is Walter, who is, He really hates his father, and basically everyone does, but you know, they can't really, they have to pretend to, because he is the local Nazi party Ortsgruppenleiter. Yeah, my German is bad. But yeah, so they and he's constantly abusing his power. And the father sends the mother away on the train, and Walter only barely, he's able to yell goodbye as it's leaving. And the only reason he was able to was because he happened to see them leaving in the car through the classroom window. And there's Jürgen, who's the son of a German officer who's been killed in action, and he hopes to live up to his father's reputation. And there's Sigi. I want to say it's short for Sigmund, but they call him Sigi. It's you know, obviously a nickname. Who's very sensitive, and his mother is somewhat poor. She washes clothes for other people, and she actually tries to arrange so that he can run away, stay with some family, you know, away from the front, and you know, not be a soldier, and he refuses. And there's actually a point where he's, you know, a soldier, you know, brings him home and says he was stealing. And she's like, okay, send him away, send him to jail, just take him away from the front. And you know, without fail, the love stuff is really charming and cute. They found some really great young actors to do it, and there's real chemistry between the, yeah. And the dialogue is really well written, well delivered, and every single acting performance is really powerful. The characters are credible and consistent, and the parents and adults have very differing opinions on the war itself, 16-year-olds going into battle and such. And yes, moving on to the short review. Die Brücke, or The Bridge, 1959. Seven 16-year-olds are sent to the front as it moves ever closer to their small, seemingly otherwise safe little town. And the, you know, they go from doing regular teen boy things, you know, there are some romantic relationships, there's, you know, they go out and play together, and they crack jokes about the war, hoping that a bomb will drop soon so that they'll miss math class. And suddenly they're deep into warfare. And it really, it's completely unflinching in showing, yeah, the brutality of fighting in, you know, both world wars saw striking brutality as industrialism, the recent marvel of industrialism, which had already been breaking human bodies, was made specifically to focus on breaking human bodies with the various vehicles, the weaponry, and the movie really in relatively short time shows a lot of really gruesome material. Moving on to thoughts, and I'm starting with plot. Now, You know, they only spend the one day in the barracks because it's, yeah, then the news come in that the Americans are approaching, and yeah, and I really liked the teacher, you know, company chef, you know, the teacher asking the company chef, please keep them out of, you know, you were a teacher, and the response is, I've been a soldier for 5 years now. He's not a teacher anymore. That's simply not, you know, and earlier we heard this teacher point, you know, soon we will need more, you know, locomotive drivers than soldiers. And, you know, I forget exactly which of the boys it is, but he's shocked at this idea. But the teacher points out, you know, it will be peacetime. The war will end soon. There's no way that it'll keep going with so much of Germany falling to the Allied forces. And so the company chef, you know, puts them on the bridge, which is already planned to be blown up. And yeah, and the, you know, the Unteroffizier leaves to get coffee, and I really like, the movie's beautifully shot through and through. This shot of him disappearing into the fog, and he's, you know, he won't be the last to disappear into the fog. And yeah, you know, he's going to inform the demolition squad, but he's mistaken for a deserter because, you know, yeah, we're going to lose the war tomorrow, but you had better not desert. You know, that is unacceptable, and that, you know, I believe that the Russians were worse than the Nazis on this, but there are cases where literally these officers who were supposed to keep people from desertion would execute, you know, people that they thought, you know, you were deserting. And, you know, very shortly after, the area was taken over by opposing forces. You know, they lost. They weren't, you know, they wouldn't have been able to hold out anyway. You know, they were executed for desertion rather than quite probably killed as, you know, as this area was taken over, or just, you know, possibly taken captive, although that again, and I believe the Russians were worse on this than the Nazis. Yeah, you know, if you didn't keep shooting, you were basically a deserter. And, you know, and yeah, this does, of course, leave the boys alone for a while, with, you know, with no contact with their officer. And yeah, and you know, the convoy of trucks comes in, and you know, they keep driving past the officer. They almost run him over when he stands with the submachine gun. And I have to, I huge props to the editor for immediately shifting. You know, we see these trucks drive past, and we, you know, it's the It's as if the army, the German army, is bleeding soldiers. You know, it's bleeding out, but it's soldiers that are just going, and we share the surprise and almost shock of the boys and then this officer, and you know, yeah, they almost run him over, and we're, you know, we see that and we think, what on earth, you can't, what are they doing? And then we see why they're driving so fast. We see all these maimed bodies lying there. Why did he stop? And just, yeah. And the, you know, you have the plane, the American fighter plane, do strafing runs. And, you know, first, oh, it's, you know, oh, it's all the way over there. And then they realize that Siegi, you know, he tried to take cover. And they laugh at him. And then when it comes closer, he refuses to, you know, take cover because, you know, they were saying that he was a coward. And then he gets killed by... And yeah, and then the tanks come in, and I suppose that might be, yeah, and then the ending with the, you know, the demolitions crew coming in and the officer there mocking them, and yeah, and the, you know, the boy shoots him, and then at the very end it's just the one who, I want to say Albert is the one who survives. I find that this was something that I do feel like All Quiet on the Western Front, the original version, the boys looked a little too similar. They did a really great job in this one. You can always tell them apart. And, you know, I mean, it is a lot to keep track of seven that you're introduced to. So, you know, and yeah, keep track of all their backgrounds and what's going on, but you know, you can watch it more than once and then from that, but they don't look alike to the point where you never look at one of them and think that it's one of the other ones. You might not completely remember the name or the exact background, but yeah, they look basically exactly as I imagined them from reading the book. Now, I should perhaps say this is my second viewing of the film. I bought it and first watched it in 2009, and I read the book for the first time in preparation for this video. And then, you know, at the end, you know, this event occurred on April 27th, 1945. It was so unimportant that it was never mentioned in any war communique. Now, apparently, apparently in reality, the survivor who, you know, yeah, I couldn't quite tell if this was really the case, but apparently the boy who survived and spoke to the journalist who wrote the book, apparently he left, you know, he walked away from the bridge and, you know, later felt guilty that you know, they stayed and were killed. And yeah, you can understand that's always, and it's, he might not have been able to do anything. He might not, you know, it might have just been another dead body, but that's the kind of thing that haunts you. Now, to briefly get into some, yeah, just briefly, in the book, the you know, it also goes into the anti-Semitism. You I want to say Walter is the, you know, Nazi party leader father. You know, he learns that there's this Jewish family, and he's going to, yeah, he brings several, I believe they're actual brown shirts, to this house. But by the time he shows up, and his son was playing with them, though he didn't know that. The mother sent the boy to the home of them with a letter, and the letter he gave to the parents, and he didn't know what was in it, but it was, of course, a warning. And so the Jewish family leave, and they actually leave this really expensive toy, it's like a toy train, mechanical toy train, in the hands of Walter. And this happened when Walter was a child, not when he was 16. It happened, I want to say he's like 7 at that point. But yeah, and he just sits there playing for hours, and then eventually the father and the brown shirts show up, and the father beats him bloody and complains to one of the others, "Come on, that's not the Jewish kid. That's my son. Look at his face." And the battle itself is longer. Now, characters. I really love and this is something that's only in the movie. Most of what's in the movie is a smaller version of what's in the book, and yeah, but this was added, and it is in part because they made the movie, you know, parts of it are in English, you know. So you have the repeat of the use of the word kindergarten. You know, you have the father saying, you know, that people his age should be, you know, in kindergarten or the like. And you know, you have the aging soldier say, "I didn't know this was a kindergarten," in the barracks. And then the American soldier uses that same word speaking English, because it is a word in English too, you know, borrowed from German. And it literally, you know, in German, it basically, kinder is child and garten is like garden. So, and, you know, he didn't mean to insult them. He was saying, "I don't want to kill a kid," you know. So yeah, and they're constantly being berated for their inexperience and their age and such, and they want to show that they're capable. And to them, especially coming from the enemy, yeah, they think they're being mocked. And it really, you know, the with the machine gun, and this is what that's what a machine gun does. It cuts his guts open and they start to come out. And he's suffering, and you have I want to say that I would just get the names wrong, but yeah, one of the boys is like yelling to Carl, you know, finish him off, because he's lying there suffering. And suddenly he realizes that Carl was already dead when he was young, and then he's like, I'm sorry I hit you. I didn't, and he thinks he killed him, because he can't comprehend, and that really, that so often happens, because our minds are not, we're not supposed to see someone die just like that, just right in front of us, and to be able, from something we didn't even see, and out comes the bayonet, which earlier they were talking about, all, you know, oh yeah, you gotta stab it in hard, and you know, because it's not sharp, it'll leave a bigger hole, and that way it won't slip out, and you have to put your foot on their chest to pull it back out, and you know, now suddenly it's real, you know, and he runs over and he's killed, you know, moments after. And the shot, and this is actually, I suppose it's possible that this isn't, you know, that they took inspiration from. In All Quiet on the Western Front, there is also a very famous sniper shot, and yeah, just I'm not going to talk about that here, but you know, in this, where you see the reflection, or rather, it's in the reflection, you see the boy as he's hit, and it's again, it's he's not realizing the severity of the situation. You can't make yourself such a big target like that, and you can't, a pistol doesn't shoot very far, and it's especially not accurate very far. You cannot use a pistol against someone who's using a rifle, and especially not at that range, and he doesn't, because he hasn't been trained that much. And yeah, and it's such a striking shot. And the, you know, the boy in the house with the Panzerfaust, you know, the man keeps telling him, don't do it, you know, there are Americans in the house, and you know, and that also, that shows, you know, when they see him the first time, he's talking about what will happen. He's talking about they will come here, get out of here, you're not safe here. And then when they see him again, yeah, the Americans are there. They're, you know, what he said came true. And, you know, not thinking, he fires the Panzerfaust, and the I forget what it's called, burn out, or yeah, you know, fries his face, and he's lying there really injured, and in comes the American, and there are these tense few seconds where you're like, is he gonna shoot him, because the kid just blew up a tank, you know, people, he just killed people, so you could understand why if the soldier, but instead he shoves him into the wall, and you know, saying, get out of here, you know, get out of this, yeah, get out of this war. And you know, but then the beams collapse in on him, And but yeah, I really appreciate whenever the English-speaking troops say anything, they speak English. And every single German speaks German. And it's such a good use of this kind of yeah, of having both languages spoken when you have that the use of the word kindergarten. And it's also there's a I forget what the movie is called, but there's this movie which it's slightly Hollywoodized, but it's still a really strong. It's about how I forget which. I want to say it's one of the two world wars, but I forget exactly. And basically, it's Christmas time, and two sides stop fighting for a little while, and there's still some animosity. There's one of the men from one side is like taunting one of the others for talking about how they were recently fighting. I don't remember the exact details. It's not completely, but at the end of the day, are we really so different? You know, excuse me, they look at each other and I mean, they. To them, this is a special time of year too. They're not even they're all Christian even. So and that was, you know, when the in both world wars, you did have Christians fighting other Christians. And I'm not saying that you should fight based on religion, but it just propaganda tries to reconfigure the mind to where and you know military training, you know severe military training where they break you down and build you back up. They teach you to look at human beings, certain human beings, as the enemy, as not. Yeah, you know, I forget. I don't hold the Amazing Atheist in particularly high regard anymore, but there was this great quote that I forget, one of his mentors basically said, every society says you can't murder human beings, and then they define certain human beings as not human. And that's, yeah, that's how you get there. You teach them, you teach people, those people are not human beings. Don't, when you look at them, don't see a human face. See this piece of propaganda or that piece of propaganda. And yeah, I forget. It's been months, but I just did a Google image search for like World War II propaganda or something, and one image was this. I want to say it was a German soldier who on his bayonet had an infant. Because if that's what when Allied troops looked at German soldiers. If they see that, I mean, of course you're gonna kill. You can't. If I don't kill this man, he's gonna walk right into my country and murder infants. And that's how you get there. That it's that's something that struck me in watching Armadillo, the Danish documentary. About a one unit in the Middle East. I wanna say Afghanistan, but I don't completely remember. Every time they talk about one of their enemies, they say him as if it, you know about all of them. There he is. There he is too. You know, as if it's like the Borg collective, as if it's this non-human entity with one shared identity that don't have any, you know, no individuality, no humanity. And yeah. And I don't have a lot more noted, but I do want to say, I think I'm in general going to get into, yeah, I'm just going to make a section called Better in the Book. And I did not take many notes for this, so it's going to be from memory. I certainly would have been wise to take notes as I was reading the book. I'm going to start with the one thing that I did note while watching that I wrote down. In the book, the bit with, you know, your father was much more gentle. In the book, this is after he finds out, after Walter finds out that he's going to the front, and he basically just, yeah, he can't really, that's, it really, he can't really deal with that, so he goes to the father's, yeah, he goes to the father's room, he gets very drunk on this, you know, liquor that, of course, the leader, you know, others are like, you know, and that's, again, that's something that's beautiful in the movie. I forget if that line is in the book, but that thing of, you know, Francisca, don't you have a watch? I traded mine in for butter, because you can't eat a watch. And it doesn't even really, he doesn't even really think about it. It didn't occur to him before she said that, but yeah, the you know, yeah, he gets really drunk on this rare liquor, and he I think he starts like smoking cigars as well. He really gets into his stash, really, the father's stash, and yeah, loudly playing jazz records. Oh wait, is that actually, I might be thinking of another scene, another part of the book. Anyway, yeah, you know, and yeah, you know, the girl comes in, and he, like, intentionally, like, you know, sexually, yeah, basically, he gropes her, even though she clearly doesn't want to, and then she says, when your father, you know, when your father does that, he's much more gentle than you, and it really shakes him out of it, and he almost sobers up a little, and then he sobs. And here, you know, I mean, it's basically the Walter, you know, is like accusing her of, yeah, having sex with his father, even though he's a married man and she is not his wife. And I mean, it's a good way to work in the line, the little, it's a good, you know, the basically it's the generational thing that he hates his father for being brutal and, you know, this authoritarian person, and yet he, you know, he suddenly is acting like his father, and, you know, the yeah, it's significantly stronger in the book. I do like, they did put in, you know, you briefly see, like, a glance between, I forget his name, but he's really hardened and cynical, and, I mean, in the book, he's basically a sociopath, and he—I mean, there are hints of that here as well. But the book—I mean, it's a a lot of the book is difficult to, you know, difficult to get through because of this content. But yeah, reading about him and what he does to other people is just really... And yeah, in the book, he ogles the female, and she's relatively young, and yeah, she's showering after, you know, gym class, and he just stands there and ogles, and he's not the only person to see her like that, because she apparently doesn't lock the door. And the I want to say the principal is, you know, he in his own head, never out loud, refers to her as the exhibitionist. And yeah, the you know, and he just keeps staring, and at first she laughs it off when a boy, you know, sees her. Yeah, she laughs it off, and he usually runs away, shy. You know, but yeah, the yeah, he stays in ovals, and I'm not 100% certain if I interpreted this right, but it seems like they... I think that it was consensual. I don't think it was a rape, but they do have sex, and she ends up pregnant, and he doesn't care. And, you know, yeah, there wouldn't have been time for all of that in this film, but they do have that little bit where he ogles her while, you know, and doesn't immediately respect her authority. I'm sorry for that. I suppose that might more or less... I think that pretty well covers the... Yeah. And I suppose the... Yeah, I'll go over some other things from the novel, but that aren't in the film. The boys do a lot of like playing in, yeah, you know, briefly it's in, and this is something that I don't think, I think it's okay that it's not in the film, because in movie shorthand, you do get the, yeah, you know, they don't take the war seriously, and they play a lot, you know. In the book, they're like, they play Americans and Indians, and then, you know, later they have to fit, well, the Americans are now the enemy. And they do a lot of, like, teenage boy stuff a lot more in the book. I suppose that more or less covers. There are with the thing with Francisca, you know, basically here in the film, it's basically, you know, she's into him and he likes her, but he doesn't really realize, you know, in the book, yeah, he becomes, it's because he's really sensitive, and some bad things happen, and then the teacher tries to get them to spend more time together. I want to say that he suggests to her that the other boy tutor her, and then he becomes really vicious to her, really controlling, and she does eventually, it gets to, I'm not going to be able to do the book justice if I try to just recount what. Now, I'm going to call this section "Be Careful Who You Hate." And I know it's dangerous to start off something like this with "I don't mean that," but I do have to in this case. I'm not saying that violence is okay. Violence is not okay except as a self-defense against greater violence. And the... yeah. However, we're never going to be able to completely eliminate violence. The more problems people have, the more violent they might get if they do get violent, and the more likely they are to get violent just in general. People who feel like they're being treated fairly and feel like they have a chance for their lives to turn out well, try not to use violence. It's something you do from anxiety and, a desire to control your surroundings because they're not being controlled. You're not being protected from the world around you. Violence is never going to be completely eliminated. We can just do what we are able to limit it. And in recent times, the austerity thing has led to more problems, less fairness, and more people having trouble getting by with money. And again, it doesn't mean that every last one of them, but gradually, more violence, more people use violence, and more violence is used when violence occurs. And that's going to take time, I'm not sure it's going to happen anytime, even starting down the right road. I figure that Trump is going to be a new Reagan, although he might be considerably less popular than Reagan, but he's going to take apart systems that were carefully crafted to make sure that the people who are worst off in America can still get by. And we're not going to be able to avoid violence and the increased violence in that time. At most, we can hope to fix these problems and to make if you know, it would help a lot if the police treated people like human beings. But the enemy, what you consider the enemy, what you consider the outgroup, a group that you give negative, that you view in a negative way. When a lot of people think that way about a group, there is going to be violence towards some of them. So I've just gone into how the violence increases, and now we're talking who does that violence hit? And this is, of course, something that the Young Turks are also very, keen on observing, that it hits the helpless. You know, it's, the Syrian refugees, non-whites who have almost nothing. And that's why you shouldn't. If you just think, if there's a person or a group where you just feel like they, whatever, they annoy you or something, if you never say that, if you never act on it, then that's one thing. But the moment that you put out there in word or deed that this group is not worth as much as, other groups, your group especially. Because there's always that's the curious thing. Whenever someone says there are groups out there who don't deserve as much, they always make sure to that they themselves and the people they care about are not in that group. Or if they are, then they're, of course, exceptions. But the moment that you put out there that this group doesn't deserve as much, then that group is going to be targeted. And it might not be violence, or it might not be strong violence, at least at first, depending on how well things are going in general, but they're going to be treated worse. That's just how that's how it's going to happen. And that's why you have to work to not hate someone who's different. I'm not telling you not to hate. Hate can be incredibly useful as long as you're using it to drive at, don't use hate as some excuse to just use violence. But if you use if you target something and say I think that is awful. It's better to do it with concepts than people, obviously, but then you can move towards addressing that issue. But don't hate people who don't have power. And I like to say that you shouldn't hate someone because of who they are unless they are a powerful person abusing their power. And obviously, again, I'm not saying use violence against them. I am saying fight them in a legal, in a constructive way. But there's always going to be violence. And because of that, I implore you to hate those who, at the end of the day, have actually done something awful or the like. If we focus and we make sure not to hate someone who hasn't, for example, committed a really violent crime or the like, then when someone goes out and does violence, then it's more likely that the violence is done to the people who have already done violence. And again, that's not okay. But it's not as bad as literally kicking down, literally ignoring dying children because of propaganda. And that's also something, if you don't care about the immediate person that you're being violent towards or spouting propaganda against or the like, think about their family. The Young Turks recently covered a few stories. The among others, there was a woman who created a Facebook profile and posed as her ex to try to destroy his life. And she did a lot of damage to his life. But she also, I'm not going to go into the details because this video is getting too long already, but his grandparents suffered because of it. And I would like to think that she just didn't think about that, that she didn't look at a person that she hates and think those he cares about should suffer too. Because it wasn't the grandparents who did that. I'm not saying there are many reasons why people hate their exes, and sometimes they're right to. Sometimes hating an ex for who they were is an important part of not going right into another relationship with a similar person. But if you're going to do something awful to another human being, just remember there are other people that are going to be affected by that. Everyone has family, friends, loved ones. There's no laser. You never hit just the one person or just the one, you know, or only that one group. You know, that's the curious thing. Hitler would talk about the Jews, and yet somehow it wasn't, he targeted other groups as well. And yeah, just turns out that it wasn't just, because the moment that you start down that road, you are going to hit more than, and that's why hatred leads to violence. So try to only hate the people who actually, especially if it's intentionally, did something awful. Hate Dylann Roof. But don't hate someone who doesn't have anything because you think that you have to compete with them because the rich rigged the system. Hate the rich. Fight the rigging of the system. But don't fight over table scraps with others who are in as bad or an even worse situation than you are.